In the car, I was debating on making a joke on Tony's stance of the major news that took place yesterday. I've elected to not go that far.
That's probably good. There's probably a line. Yeah,
that's probably the line.
Yeah, so that's good.
Yes.
Especially since he's not here.
Especially since he's not here to defend
himself.
Yeah, that would be, I think, too far. So, yeah.
But I like, at least I like where your mind's at.
I was thinking, I was like, do... because we don't talk about that stuff on this show.
Right.
And I think all three of us are all very aligned on our actual thoughts.
Yeah.
It's, you know, a very good result. But yeah,
absolutely.
I was like, do I take Tony's, the joke of Tony being an alt-right person this far? And I'm not going to.
I appreciate that you considered it, at least.
Yeah. I'm not going to bring that up on the show.
But yeah.
All right, let's get started.
Way up we go, been up and down that road. Way up, oh no, we gon' burn the whole house down. Watch me standing in line, you're only serving lies. You got something to hide, we gon' burn the whole house down.
What's up, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of Underpaid and Overrated. I am Noah Hiles. He is
Michael Garr.
And just Michael Garr. Yes, it is just the two of us again. Tony is off in Colorado.
Celebrating a birthday or something. Dude,
I mean, who does this guy think he is? Doing a trip.
16-year-old girl, that's what he thinks.
A trip on your birthday?
Yeah, celebrate. The whole month it has to be, apparently. So
I mean, come on now.
Yeah.
And it's in April. You know, I don't know. I have...
questionable.
And, yeah. And like we talked about in pre-show, this could be an opportunity to make more jokes, but I'm not going to. I'm not going to. Tony's not here. He's still a part of the show, and he is a good person. We're just going to leave it at that. So, Garr, looking over the world of sports right now, obviously the Pirates and the Tigers are duking it out in a series that all of Major League Baseball is infatuated with.
Yeah.
A doubleheader heard around the world.
Yeah. Not that A's Twins game that I don't know if you saw the results
yes,
of that.
13-12.
Yeah. No one watched that. It's all
all
eyes focused on Comerica right now.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
The two cornerstones of Major League Baseball. But speaking of cornerstones and valuable franchises, the main sports news this week has been the Super League. And for those who do not follow soccer, what happened was on Sunday. News broke that there would be a new soccer league being formed where six teams in the Premier League, three teams from La Liga in Spain, and three teams from Serie A in Italy, 12 of the more notable, lucrative football clubs in the world would all be leaving their leagues from in their country and competing in a Super League. Now, as Americans, our initial response to this, for those who don't watch soccer, would think this is cool. This is kind of like, you know, just the NFL forming or something, you know, just like the superpowers. However, this was met with probably the most universal hate I have ever seen when it came to a sports decision. Everyone in England was heartbroken by this because what it meant was it takes away the Premier League would become significantly less popular, significantly less meaningful. It would pretty much destroy Champions League, and it would take away from all the other tournaments and everything that come along with European soccer, the FA Cup, the Euro Cup. There were reports saying that UEFA or FIFA, one of the two, would not allow players who played in this Super League to compete in the World Cup. So if a player was on Chelsea or Real Madrid or Barcelona or something, Christian Pulisic, for example, America's best player, plays for Chelsea, he would not be able to play for the United States in the World Cup if they're ever good enough to get back there if this league came to fruition. So there was a lot of heat on it. Garr, did you pay attention to this story at all? Was this something that really captured your attention?
Well, I think the only thing that captured my attention, look, I'm not a soccer guy. I love the World Cup. I love especially the Women's World Cup because that's a lot more favorable for the U.S. Yeah.
Yes.
I don't really watch the Premier League, I think mainly because don't know a lot of the players and they just start so early our time and I just can't get into it. I've tried. I have a lot of friends who are, but it's the thing that caught my eye is what you said is how much everyone hated it. Just hated the idea. And I don't know, I can't remember the last time someone or something in the sports world drew so much hate. I mean, it just seemed like maybe two people. I think Pat McAfee was all for it. I think he was the notable guy that he was on board with.
KFC Barstool was all for it as well.
Okay. So, yeah, a couple here and there. But for the most part, it just seemed like everyone was against it. I don't know enough about soccer, but it just seemed kind of slimy, the whole thing. It just seemed greedy.
What it meant, and I listened to some podcasts. Part of My Take did a really good job covering it on Monday. But I read some articles in The Athletic and different stuff. And there was a guy who used to play for Manchester United who went on he delivered a great monologue on one of the NBC shows. I can't remember which one it was. But basically, the general synopsis is this: is the Premier League, yes, while it is dominated by Liverpool, Chelsea, Man U, Man City, those four of the six clubs that we're going over there are the ones who kind of own the league. What's cool about European soccer, specifically English soccer, is that there are these powerhouse teams. And then also in the Premier League, there are these teams that play in stadiums with 2,000 people. Leicester City was, I'm sure, a story you're familiar with. They won the Premier League a couple years ago. Mm-hmm. They were 6,000-1.
Yeah,
their odds to win that, and they came up and they won the whole damn thing. And it takes away opportunities for that to happen. But what's also cool is players on those clubs who play for the Leicester Cities, the Hull Cities, the very small teams, they get the opportunity to play at Old Trafford, to play in Liverpool, to play at Man U and Man City, and play in these cathedrals, these soccer, holy grounds, kind of like, the Pirates get a chance to play at Wrigley Field or Dodger Stadium and stuff like that. So that's a big thing. And another thing about it is a very popular thing in European soccer is relegation. Are you familiar with that is?
Yep.
Yeah. So the bottom three teams in the league every year, they go down to the lower level league and the top three teams in that league come up. So, and there's instances where teams who originally started in like the fifth lowest league can get hot and work their way up to play in the Premier League and they don't have a budget nearly the same. Like there'll be one player on Liverpool that makes more than their entire payroll, but they earn their way there. And that kind of takes away from all of this. So there's just no tradition. It takes away from the pure sport and the culture of soccer where it's so intimate and so passionate. And I don't know. Well, it really commercialized something that they really did not want money to come into. And it hurt them even more because a lot of the owners of these clubs that are making these choices, like Liverpool, like Arsenal, are owned by Americans. Stan Kroenke, the Rams owner that moved them from St. Louis to Los Angeles, he owns Arsenal. They make if this league happened, every team would get $400 million the moment it started. That's why they wanted to do this.
Yeah, it's a shame. A lot of it goes. It's all kind of about money and everything. Again, I'm not too familiar with all these teams or whatnot, but if I was a fan, those were the things you listed, the tradition, just, playing in different stadiums and just having the league the way it is. I mean, I think there's something to be said for that, kind of referring to what you said about the Pirates, like the Pirates stink, but the Tigers stink too. I love it when they come here. I love the scheduling and stuff like that. And it goes for all sports.
Here's what it actually reminded me of. As someone who grew up, we grew up around the same time, we were around to see the end of Big East basketball.
Yep.
And this kind of reminded me of when the Big East fell apart. And there haven't been many teams since the Big East was, since it really kind of dissolved into what it is now that have gone up since that. I mean, UConn has gone down, Pitt's gone down, Georgetown has gone down, St. John, Seton Hall, all the originals. The only team that's really gotten better has been Villanova, who is, you know, a top five program in the country now. But every other team has really fallen apart, and it's because the Big East was something that was a recruiting chip. Getting to play in the Big East, getting to play against
Madison Square Garden.
Yeah, getting to play at Madison Square Garden, getting to play against Big John Thompson, Coach Calhoun, Jim Boeheim. You know, and that's kind of what this Premier League thing reminded me of, where even if teams like Providence or, you know, DePaul, when they were in there, you could still get kids to come to that school and say, listen, you're going to be in the Big East. And that's kind of how Ben Howland built
Any Big East school could get any New York guy at all.
Yes, that's like Ben Howland, when he built a program and then Jamie Dixon kind of took it to the next level, they were able to go get a Carl Krauser in the Bronx and get those guys, the Brandon Knights or whatever, and say, listen, we're not Georgetown, but you'll have a chance to play against Georgetown on ESPN multiple times. And you'll have a chance to play against Kemba Walker or Carmelo Anthony and Jerry McNamara and all those guys. And that's what this reminded me of. And how college sports really became commercialized. And I could see, you know, this people were using the analogy. Well, this would be like the NFL, where the Steelers, the Cowboys, the Packers, the NFC East, and a couple other teams created their own league. At the end of the day, all of those teams are worth $1 billion. So it's not the same. But the comparison is very valid for college basketball and more, college football, because there are only a handful of teams that really dominate college football. It's been Clemson and Alabama, sprinkle in Ohio State over the last decade plus. So that could happen in college football. I mean, I don't think it will happen or whatever, but teams already hate the NCAA. They can make more money on their own. So if this were to happen, I would like to go through now and create our Super League for college football and college basketball. I don't want to do this combined, where we pick 12 schools to play both. I just want to pick a Super League for 12 for each. So we'll start with college football. I think we both know who the first team is.
Okay, so we're doing 6 or 12?
12. We're doing 12 for college football, 12 for college basketball.
Okay, well, the first one's obvious. It's Alabama.
Yes, I already have my 12 picked. I want to see if you pick this, how many of my 12 that you pick. All right, so you got Bama.
Okay. I have Alabama, and this is off the top of my head. Clemson.
Yes.
Ohio State.
Mm-hmm.
So that's 3. Although they haven't won a title, I would throw Notre Dame in there.
I mean, Notre Dame, that's the thing. People shit on Notre Dame. Notre Dame makes the playoffs every year. Yeah. They're winning 10, 11 games. And who do they lose to in the champ or in the playoffs every year? They lose to Clemson or Alabama.
Right.
By 20. And they normally win the championship by 20 anyway. So, Notre Dame is on Notre Dame. Ohio State's level, in my opinion.
Yeah, so that's 4, right? Okay. Mm-hmm. Let's see what else. I would go out west. I'm going to go Oregon.
Oregon? I did not have Oregon.
You don't have them on your list? I think they would be like – it'd be like the kind of the sneak team that maybe sneaks in a little.
Okay.
LSU.
I have LSU.
I would go. Sam, now I'm trying to think Big Ten. You know, I'm so tempted to say Michigan, but they're not good. They're not good, though.
So when I made my list, I looked at two things. I considered history.
They just have not been.
But here's the thing. This Super League has teams like Arsenal. Arsenal is the English equivalent of the Knicks or the Cowboys.
Okay.
Where in like the, you know.
Recognizable name, but
historical Arsenal is one of the top three probably biggest names in all of soccer. It's like Manchester United, Liverpool, Arsenal for Premier League. Like Chelsea is huge now. Chelsea's kind of like Clemson, where like they got relevant recent and now they're just a powerhouse, or like the Chiefs with Mahomes or something. But Arsenal is like the Dallas Cowboys, where they're an absolute mess of an organization right now. But historically, they are, I mean, they're one of the most lucrative sports franchises in the world. So that's where you could consider Michigan. But and that's when I was making my list. I was looking at how much money do these programs gross, and these. I was thinking of 12 teams. When they're good, sports writers will have a column saying college football is better, when X is doing well.
Is doing well. Okay. So, fair enough. So, okay. Well, then I'll say Michigan.
I had Michigan in mind.
Okay. All right. So that's six.
You have six.
Okay.
And we have five of this. We have five.
We have five of the same six. Yes. Okay. I'm going to go back to the SEC and say Florida.
Okay. Florida was not on. Florida was on my just missed list.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I think. Well, now I feel like Big 12's got to come in. I'm going to say Texas.
Texas is the most lucrative college football program in the country. They have to be in this.
Yeah, they have to be on the list.
Because here's the thing. What is the saying every time Texas wins a big game?
Hook 'em?
No, they always say Texas is back.
Oh, Texas is back.
That is
oh,
like Texas the is main thing you see on Twitter. If they beat Oklahoma or Oklahoma State.
Texas is back.
Or if they get a bid to like the Rose Bowl or something, everyone will always say, oh, back. Texas is back. It's Vince Young 05 again. They're back. Yeah. Earl Campbell. Yeah. You know, but they're never back.
Yeah, but they're never actually back. Yeah. Okay. So Texas.
Mm-hmm. I had them.
You had them. I'm trying to think. I don't know if you're going to have this, but I kind of like Wisconsin.
Wisconsin was on my just missed list.
Just missed. Well. I like them on that.
They're
list.
A top 15 most lucrative program. Camp Randall Stadium, like a classic in college football.
They're really to me right behind Michigan.
I mean,
and Ohio
you think?
State
yeah,
the
I
Big
mean,
Ten.
They're just they're not like ever going to win a national championship. But Wisconsin,
but they're
you
there.
Can put them in Sharpie to win 9 games, if not
always.
10. They're going to have a lineman that's a top prospect. And, like they're going to have a kid who runs for 1,700 yards
to get into the playoffs. They always need help. They're always
doorstep. They're watching Ohio State.
Yeah.
And just praying they lose to Michigan.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that way they're like, that way they have one loss. Yep. We have one loss.
Yep. But their one loss every year is always like, it's like Northwestern
or Northwestern
Minnesota.
On an 11 o'clock Saturday afternoon.
Yep. And that's what costs them. And
they lose like 12-0. Yeah.
Exactly. Oh my God. Okay.
All right.
Okay. Let's go Florida State.
I have Florida State on there.
Florida State.
And they're not necessarily as lucrative, but you got to have a Florida team. And I took them over the Gators simply for the history. I think you could also put Miami.
I was going to say Miami.
Well, but
Miami
money wise, I just think Florida State pulls in the most out of those three.
So is that 10 for me?
You have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. You need one more.
Okay.
You're missing a huge one.
Couple like that one, come to mind. Is there one really obvious one?
Yeah, there's one that like makes the playoffs every year and gets bounced in the first round that you haven't named yet. And they're a top 5 program of all time.
What conference? Who am I missing?
It's the Heisman University. At least in the last 5 years.
What the hell am I? Not Auburn.
No.
Who am I? Give me the conference.
Big 12.
Why am I drawing a blank?
Oklahoma.
Oklahoma. Okay.
You got to put them in yours, right?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
So that will be your 12. Your 12 is Alabama.
I was so set on like Texas Tech or.
Yeah, I mean, in Oklahoma
for sure.
Should be in there.
For sure. Yeah.
So Alabama, yours is Alabama, Clemson, Ohio State, Notre Dame, Oklahoma, LSU, Texas, Florida State, Michigan, Oregon, Florida, and Wisconsin.
Yep.
My 12 was a little different. I had. Okay. Bama, Clemson, OSU, Notre Dame, Oklahoma, LSU. I had USC.
Okay.
Fight on, Trojans. And that is, to me, aside from Texas, Texas is their back. But when USC is like 6-1 and it's November, there is a column saying college football is better when USC is good. Because, you know, USC, Notre Dame, and you got the fight on and the trumpets and the Trojan and all of it. Everyone just thinks it's Pete Carroll time all over again, and their uniforms and the cheerleaders and the Rose Bowl. And it is the most commercial college football program in the country, in my opinion.
Okay.
There are teams that are more lucrative. There are teams with better traditions of winning. But when you think of like glitz and glamour, a 6'4" white dude running the pro style offense at USC is as American as it gets.
That's sure.
He threw for 4,000 yards his senior year of high school. His name is probably Matt.
Yeah, right, exactly. Yeah, that's yeah. funny.
I had Texas and Florida State.
Okay.
I had Michigan. So my last two teams where we differed, you took Oregon, Wisconsin, Florida, and Wisconsin. Yep. I had my three teams that were different were USC, Georgia.
Georgia,
the,
yeah.
The second most yeah. lucrative program in college football behind Texas. Yeah. If you look at recruiting year in and year out, Georgia beats Alabama's ass normally. Mm-hmm. They're getting the top player in the country more often than not. They're getting five stars. They just don't have coaching. Kirby Smart's a moron. And I mean, they've been yeah. in position to take they've down been Alabama
the a couple times.
I mean, yep. They were ahead of Alabama in the second half of the national championship game, I think in 2018, yeah. and a backup came in and beat them. So yep. they have all the talent in the world. I mean, you look they every team in the NFL has someone from Georgia on it.
Sure.
Yeah. So Georgia is my second team that we differed on. And my third team was Auburn. And my mentality was this: if this Super League forms, Ohio State's not going in it without Michigan, and Alabama's not going in it without Auburn.
That's a good point. That's a good
point.
So
yeah. that's how I rationalize it. Auburn also a program. I mean, they've won a national title in the last 15 years. They've been to multiple national championship games, and they're the only team that can consistently compete with Alabama.
Yep.
That's not named Clemson.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they're responsible for Alabama not making it to the national championship game more than any other team in the last 20 years.
Right.
So you got to probably throw them in.
Yeah, I like
my
that.
My honorable mentions, I did not have Oregon on my list at all. Oregon's a cool program, but I just don't think they're lucrative enough. I mean, I'm saying that about a university that's pretty much owned by Nike. So yeah. that is probably an incorrect take to have. I just don't see them in the top pantheon of college football. Florida and Wisconsin,
I think they get ignored a little just because they're out west. It's like the Pac-12, but I yeah. always think they're hovering.
Yeah,
you're probably a bigger college football fan than me.
I think. So, but 10 years ago, Chip with Kelly, the Oregon
years, Chip Kelly. Yeah. yeah, I think they've had their moments. They've definitely yes. had their shots. So
yeah.
They were, I put them in only because just, I couldn't think of Oklahoma.
Oregon doesn't feel like Oregon to me. Because they don't score 80 points a game anymore.
Right.
You know, and it was even after Chip Kelly, like you said, like the Marcus Mariota days, the, you know, Dennis Dixon, the Michael James, mm-hmm. They were just a track team. Mm-hmm. You know, they were the first team to really do the high octane, no huddle with mm-hmm. hold up the cards that had pictures of
they were
like
cool.
SpongeBob cool. and everything yep. like their plays. Like yeah. they were so innovative, and then they didn't have the same uniform any game. And
every single,
they were
that,
so
it was like,
cool.
oh, I got the new uniform. And then you look on the screen, just, it's like, what the hell is that?
When they had Justin Herbert at quarterback, who was awesome, who was really good, but I'm like, this isn't an Oregon quarterback. This guy, come on. I mean, yeah. no, an Oregon quarterback is someone who's 6 foot, runs a 4.3 40, and can't throw a ball more than 35 yards downfield. That's an Oregon quarterback, yeah. in my opinion, even though yeah. Mariota and Dennis Dixon could both
could,
do that.
Yeah, but still.
But my missed teams, I had Wisconsin and Florida. Okay. Nebraska is a team that absolutely owned football pretty much from the 70s to the 90s.
Yeah, I mean, they popped in my head, but recently
they are a joke. They kind of are an Arsenal, though, where you could make an argument like they still pull their program, still a huge money pit. Mm-hmm. Penn State is a borderline program.
Yeah.
But my point is, you take Michigan over Penn State because of the rivalry. Penn yeah. State. They refuse to acknowledge their top rival because, hey, Penn State, who's your top rival? Well, I guess what? You're not theirs. It's not yeah. Michigan. It's exactly. not Ohio State. It's exactly. not Michigan State. You know, right. your top rival should be Pitt, but you think you're too good for them. Whatever. Yeah. Joe knew. Florida, and then two other sleepers for this. Tennessee.
Okay.
Tennessee is a crazy lucrative program for, I mean, they were good in the 90s. They won right. the championship in 98.
It was Manning's. Yeah.
It was after the year after Manning left, actually.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Did Manning not win one?
No, Manning did not win one. He didn't win a Heisman or a champion. They won it the year after Manning graduated.
Okay.
And then they were in the national championship, I believe, in 2000. Like the first year of the BCS, they were. So, like, they had a run in the 90s, and they're still trying to get back there. They're a joke of a program now, but they still produce pro talent, and they are a money pit as well. Their stadium is huge. Mm-hmm. It's one of the biggest in the country. It is, yeah. And they were part of that game that was played at Talladega a couple years ago. Do you remember that? There was like, I think there was like 140,000 people that went to it like that. It was crazy.
Damn. Where'd they play?
I want to say Florida, maybe. Florida or Georgia, some other SEC school.
Yeah.
And then my last team, Washington, a sneaky, lucrative program out west. You want to talk about programs that don't get any love? Washington. The Huskies get no love, but they've been to the college football playoff since it's been formed the 1 year. They're normally a decent team, and they pack that stadium. All-time weird camera angle in that in those games, as someone who loves to bet on them because they're always the night game. And they have a good history, so they were on my missed list. We'll do college basketball real quick.
Sure.
Before we dive in, or as we dive in, I just want to make it real clear that before you even say these names, six teams belong on this more than anything. And it's the six blue bloods of college basketball. It's Duke, North Carolina, UCLA, Kentucky, Kansas, and Indiana.
Yep.
Those six programs, and Indiana absolutely blows in college basketball.
You still put them in
there. You have to put them in there because that is the basketball capital of the world.
Yep.
Or at least for people who shoot jump shots.
Indiana's the exactly. Indiana's
It's North Carolina, Kentucky, Indiana, and New York, or your four, New York City, not the state, just New York City,
right,
are the four basketball capitals of the world. You put those six programs in. I think the other six spots are up for debate. You can go ahead and name the rest of those six.
Okay. Like you said, UNC, Duke, UCLA, Indiana, Kansas, Kentucky. Mm-hmm. I would probably say – see, I don't know. I kind of like the idea of Syracuse.
I have Syracuse in mind.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. They have the second winningest coach of all time. They've won a national championship. Every year they go to March Madness, they're a Sweet 16 team. And, I mean, we're taken back by them because of them not being who they were when we were younger, when Syracuse was a top 10 team every year. But, I mean, they're still successful. And they play in one of the more legendary venues in college basketball, the Carrier Dome. Mm-hmm. So – I do think Syracuse belongs in this.
Okay. Gonzaga.
I have Gonzaga as well.
They don't win, but they are there in the conversation.
They are a one seed. They're a one seed every single year. Now, like we said before, this is not the Gonzaga team we grew up watching where it's they have Adam Morrison and a whole bunch of guys who are going to be, selling insurance in five months. Like, they have lottery picks every year. They just got one of the top recruits in the country yesterday.
Yeah.
So yeah, they're legit.
I would go UConn.
UConn on my missed list.
Just missed.
Just missed. I like just UConn. Because they haven't done anything since Calhoun. Well, they won the one championship after Calhoun, but really since the Big East disbanded, I think this was their first time back in the tournament in like 5 years.
Okay. I'm going to say Michigan again.
I have Michigan in mind.
And
it's a basketball school.
It is a basketball school.
They really don't want you to say that.
But it is. They've had so much more success.
They won a national championship in 89. They had the Fab Five that like changed college basketball in the early 90s.
Yep.
They simmer down a bit, but then Beeline comes in and builds something very special there. And they've been the only Big Ten team that can get deep in the tournament recently. Yeah. I mean, if they had livers this tournament, they would have went to the national. Well, they would have went to the Final Four. They would have beat UCLA. They probably would have lost to Gonzaga. Yeah. But they would have been a Final Four team.
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, sure. Michigan is definitely on there. They're regular in the Elite Eight now.
Speaking of Michigan teams, you got to go with Izzo and Michigan State.
Yep,
they got to be on.
It's January. February Izzo. Yep. That's how it goes. Exactly. Even though they haven't done, they haven't been in the Final Four. They were in the Final Four like not too long ago. I think 2018 or something.
Yeah.
Because they beat Zion's team.
Okay.
To go to the Final Four.
Okay. So where am I at? Am I 9 or 10?
You have 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. You only need one more.
Okay. Who do I have? Syracuse.
You have Syracuse, Michigan State, Michigan, Gonzaga, the six blue bloods, and UConn.
And UConn for 11. Okay.
I think you're pulling an Oklahoma again.
You think Oklahoma? Because I was going to say Texas.
No, not Oklahoma. I'm saying you're pulling an Oklahoma like you did for college football. There's an obvious one that you're missing.
Really?
Yes. Probably the best overall college basketball program in the last 5 years.
Well, I can't say Texas then.
Definitely not.
Give me a conference.
No. Okay. Not going to do that. But, I mean, just think of March Madness the last 5 years, who's been the most dominant team?
Ohio State, Illinois, big I don't know.
It's Villanova.
Villanova. Jesus. That crossed my mind like 3 minutes ago and I forgot about them. Mm-hmm. Because I said Syracuse or whatever. Villanova, absolutely Villanova. They've won two national championships in the last 5 years.
Yes, and they are, I mean, they were not even at full strength this year and waltzed into the Sweet 16. Yeah. They're a great
Villanova,
program.
100%.
Okay, so the only team that we had different, I had Louisville as my 12th team.
Louisville, yeah. Yeah.
Simply because, with Patino, they were upper echelon, you know, top 10 program in the country year in, year out. They won the championship in 13, even though that's been vacated. But they have a huge building in the KFC, with the KFC exclamation point, Yum Center.
Fun tidbit. I called a women's basketball game in that stadium via cell phone. The equipment did not work. I held my iPhone up and I had to just broadcast the entire
game. That's still really cool.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a really nice stadium. Yeah.
It's a big venue. It's a very lucrative program and they've always got a guard that can, you know, that is a top five player in the country and is nothing in the NBA. Russ Smith, Peyton Silva, or whatever his name is. Like, they've always got this guy.
I forgot about that guy. Oh my God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. They've had others too.
Yep.
Yes.
And you never hear from them again.
And then every year in March, it's the guy that's like, just drive to the hoop. When they're down by one, yet he pulls up from three and absolutely air balls or bricks it. And that's how their season ends. That's typical Louisville. Oh my missed teams. Arizona. Okay. Arizona, after the DeAndre Ayton stuff became nothing, they just fired Sean Miller. But prior to that, Arizona was the symbol of stability in college basketball.
They made the tournament
20 something years. They won the championship the 1 year. Sean Miller was a great coach. He still is. He's going to be a great coach again. He just needs to disappear for a couple years and then he's going to go to some mid-major. He'll go to like St. Louis or something like that. Yeah, exactly. Like take the Billikens to the Elite Eight once, and then all of a sudden he'll be at, Indiana or something. Right. They just fired his brother, so maybe not Indiana, but he'll be at Kansas after they fire Bill Self. Arizona, Texas was on my honorable mention just because of that school is just a money pit.
And they're always they feel like
they always have a guy. They always have a lottery pick. I mean, they got a Mo Bamba or something, you know, some kid who his numbers aren't that great, but he's projected to be a great NBA player. And then I had UConn on my almost list, and then I had Georgetown. Because to me, UConn has been far more successful. They've won more national championships than Georgetown. But I think brand recognition, they're at the same level. Yeah. I mean, Georgetown was the coolest college basketball team in the world when college basketball became what it is in like the modern world. You know, when the Big East was thriving, when you think of the Big East, you think of, if you ask people who watched like the OG Big East, you think of Big John Thompson, Patrick Ewing. Mm-hmm. After Ewing, it was Alonzo Mourning. They had Allen Iverson when we were watching them, Roy Hibbert. Uh-huh. Like they were the dudes.
They had some great teams.
That's what about, an all-time college basketball uniform as well.
Yeah. Oh yeah. If there's any team in any sport, professional, college, that can pull off gray, Mm-hmm. I mean, man, they do it well.
Yeah, they really do. And it's just they're just cool. They're just cool, you know. Yeah. And it's just Georgetown is it's not like you look at some of these other programs like UCLA. They've had success in football. That's a great academic school. It's glitz and glamour out in California. You know, Michigan has a great football program. Syracuse has had some years or whatever. Georgetown, you don't know them for anything else. It's a basketball school. It's a true basketball school. I mean, it's also a fantastic academic institution, but it is a basketball school. And that's why I put that on the list.
Another fun tidbit. I have been to a Georgetown football game, little Georgetown Cornell. It was about 100 degrees and it was high school bleachers. I've seen high schools with bigger stadiums than Georgetown mm-hmm. football, but it was something. I don't recommend it. I don't.
Do you have any other college basketball programs you'd like to throw in there?
Yeah, the one that comes to mind, they've kind of come back on the map a little with some recent success is Houston. Houston's okay. obviously had a history in the past.
I'm gonna throw lately, one more in there.
Okay, yeah, NC State, maybe a little.
No, NC State gets famous because some guy caught a buzzer beater. He caught an air ball and put it in before the buzzer, and Jimmy V ran around with his arms wide out.
Yeah, all right. Okay.
Listen, I'm a big fan of what Jimmy V has done for cancer research and everything, but that whole thing gets way overblown. All right. In my opinion, survive in advance. If you laugh,
that's a good 30.
You cry, 30. And I'm not here to talk bad on Jimmy V. I'm sorry. He's a great human being. Virginia should be at least considered for this list as well. Just their power in college basketball, what Michigan has become for the Big Ten, Virginia has become for the ACC. Mm-hmm. They've consistently finished ahead of Duke and North Carolina in the regular season standings. They've won the ACC tournament multiple times, and they've won a national championship recently. Sure, they also got beat by a 16 seed recently.
But
I just think that Virginia is...
They're always there.
Well, and then they have such a specific brand for college basketball, too. When you see a high school team that just plays great defense and has solid ball movement, everyone says, oh, they play like Virginia. You know, when we were younger, they would compare it to Wisconsin. Virginia kind of took that. Tony Bennett kind of took that to the next level. So that would be... those are our super leagues. And to be honest, Gar, I don't root for any of those teams in these 12 leagues, but I would watch this because
I pull for Michigan. I don't follow them as closely as to consider myself like a diehard fan, but I do like Michigan. I'm glad they would make both super leagues. Although
I'm a former UCLA basketball
Michigan football, I feel like would be in the bottom of the super league. Most years.
I think they would be better. I mean, they're better than Florida State is right now.
Okay. Well,
they're a better program they would be bottom third for sure. Or bottom fourth. Yeah. They would struggle, but hey,
that's okay. What are you gonna do? They make it up. That'd be basketball. I would be curious to see how everyone fares. I think you could get a lot of fun results out of those 12 basketball teams.
It would hurt me more if they did a super league for college hoops than college football, because college football, I like seeing the upsets in college football, and it is cool. Like we talked about how the small Premier League teams get to play at, you know, Old Trafford. It's cool to see kids, you know, who play at Illinois or Northwestern get to play at the Big House or the Horseshoe or something like that. You know, that's a similar thing. But college football every year, it's two teams right now.
Right.
And normally, historically, there's every decade there's just three or four who really
just
determine
dominate,
everything.
Just run it.
They get the best recruits. They have the best coaches, and they win it all every year.
Just the way it
college
is.
Basketball, without those 12 teams in March Madness, I would be heartbroken. If they didn't qualify, that's one thing. I mean, that would be a shitty tournament if all 12 of those programs could not make it at a 60, could not get 68 spots. If you took Duke away from March Madness, if you took Gonzaga away from March Madness, North Carolina, UCLA, like that would break my heart. Like I would be crushed. And because college basketball, while, yeah, normally a one seed does end up winning it, there is a little bit more parity to it. And what makes it more exciting is the Dukes and the North Carolinas, they do lose in March Madness.
Yep.
To, like, Duke, I mean, loses to Lehigh. And
right.
Virginia, like we said, loses the UCMB or whatever they were named.
Whatever, the Maryland, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And, like, you get way more Cinderella stories with that sport. So that would suck. So, all right. So moving away from the Super League talk and moving on to another sporting event that was 100% money driven and very watered down. Jake Paul knocked out Ben Askren in the Triller pay-per-view, I believe is what it was called. 30 seconds in. I watched it. I didn't pay a dime for it, thankfully. I streamed it. Hey, Jake Paul, I illegally streamed your fight on YouTube. I did not pay a dime for it. Come sue me. I hope he doesn't hear that. But
well, yeah. Well, let me just say, I refuse to watch anything that Jake Paul does. I am not a Logan Paul guy. Logan Paul, at least, is very famous at OU. Well, he's famous everywhere now, but he was famous at OU because he went there freshman year.
That's where he got Vine famous.
Right, and no one liked him. I think a lot of people thought he was not very funny at all. I actually saw him at a party once, didn't talk to him. But I don't like him. Then I see Jake Paul, and I'm like, well, this guy can't be worse. And he's like 50 times worse.
Oh, a billion times worse.
He's the absolute worst human being alive.
Well,
okay, maybe that's a little strong, but he sucks.
Considering what happened in the news yesterday, we shouldn't throw those huge generalizations out there, but go ahead.
I guess you're right. But he sucks. I think we can agree that he does suck. So I will never pay to watch any of his fights ever. I have one buddy who bet against him, bet the Ben guy or whatever. And
Askren.
Yeah. And he lost some money. So feel bad for that dude. But other than that, man, it's just, I don't know, man. I don't know.
First things first, I actually don't hate Logan Paul. Compared to his brother, he is a breath of fresh air.
You're telling me.
One. And two, I did not like Logan Paul for a long time. I found him very, annoying or whatever.
So did I.
But I actually have kind of, I don't know, I don't really listen to his podcast or whatever, but I've kind of paid attention to what he's done recently. And I think he has actually grown up. Like, there was that incident where he filmed a person who committed suicide, and that's like got him in a huge amount of trouble. And I think since that event, he's really grown up, and the content that he makes now is more, it's not like anything amazing, but it's on the same level as like a Barstool or whatever, where they just have like entertainment talk or whatever. Yeah. And I do think a lot of what he did was actually kind of innovative. I mean, he was one of the few people from Vine who was able to make a very lucrative career from going from 6-second videos to vlogging. And now he's moving into, podcasting and NFTs and everything like that. Yeah. He's got a very smart business mind, where Jake, I think, is just chaotic and kind of follows his brother's footsteps.
I agree. I'll give Logan this. I didn't like his vines at all. I didn't think he was funny. I still don't really think he's funny. I haven't watched a lot of things. But he's obviously had success, and he's gotten a lot older. And I think you're right. From some of the stuff I've seen with what he's done with Barstool, maybe he's gotten a little more mature. So I guess I give him that. Jake, I mean, holy Lord. I don't know if I could stand in the same room with him for a minute without what the fuck.
He is a human version of a pile of cocaine.
But the thing is, like, he just does, you're right, he does the same thing, kind of follows in his brother's footsteps, does all these like YouTube videos and everything, and he makes millions, and he's like just a total asshole about the whole thing. Like, I'm rich and I can do whatever the hell I want.
Yeah.
And you know what? Yeah, he can do whatever he wants, but maybe you could be a little more subtle about it.
But here, Jake Paul's proof that nothing sells better than a good heel.
Mm-hmm.
And like what Howard Stern said. Oh, Dalton's calling me now. I'll just text him. What was I gonna say?
Howard Stern.
Dalton threw me. Oh, Howard Stern said, yeah. The people who love me listen for 30 minutes. The people who hate me listen for an hour. And that is Jake Paul to a T. Yep. Where, yeah, he does have a loyal following of, like, you know, 15-year-olds who think he's cool. But there are a lot of people, like our age, who watch this video, just hate watching it, being like, what an asshole. Look at this idiot. You know, the whole time. But that view gets him money.
Exactly.
And
so you got to be smart, and you just have to not vote.
And he is smart. He is smart enough to recognize that people are going to pay $50 hoping to see me get my ass kicked.
Right.
And he hired this dude. He paid this guy, Ben Askren, to fight, who has a good record in UFC. He's also is on the wrong end of the fastest knockout in UFC history. Yeah. 6 seconds. Jorge Masvidal fights this weekend. Very excited to watch that. Anyway, I'll give Jake Paul props on this. The dude trains his ass off. I mean, he comes in, and I didn't watch his last fight against Nate Robinson. I didn't watch his first fight or whatever, but I do follow him on Instagram, and I see, like, he's working hard. I have read, like, he's hiring legit trainers. He's dieting. He's not drinking or doing drugs or whatever. Like, he's preparing for this like a real boxer would. And he did look smooth in the ring. He actually looks like someone who deserves to fight a real boxer. I mean, if he fought like Tyson Fury, he would get killed. But like, I mean, Ben Askren is a 2-time national champion wrestler, 2-time All-American, one of the best wrestlers in college wrestling, I think, like, ever. And he moved to the UFC, where he's had a very successful and lucrative career. He has a decent following for, you know, MMA standards. And he's very well respected in the fight community. The dude clearly did not train at all. Did you see what he looked like with his shirt off?
Yeah, I did. I notice that. I was like, oh my God.
He looks like me right around this time of the year, where I look in the mirror and go, oh boy. All right. Yeah. We got to diet for 3-4 weeks and we got to start running. That's what we got to do around this time of the year.
Yeah.
He looked like shit. And I mean, he didn't. His box, he literally said, like, in his pregame interviews, like, if this guy actually knows how to box, I'm in trouble.
Right.
Like, he said that.
Does, yeah.
And then he got knocked out and he walked away smiling with $500,000 in his pocket and probably some more after they had to pay everything. But I want to talk about the actual pay-per-view real quick, because you didn't watch it.
Yep.
This was the worst event I've ever seen organized. And I've covered high school tennis. I have covered, you know, high school rugby. I was more entertained at those than watching this. They threw concert after concert. They had Doge Cat or whatever her name is. They had Justin Bieber perform before the main fight. They had the D'Amelio girls or whatever, the two TikTok teenagers who have like 60 million followers each on TikTok, the dancers. They were there like handing out belts and stuff. All the prelim fights that I watched were A, snooze fests, and that's my main gripe with any boxing pay-per-view, is that UFC pay-per-views are so much better than boxing pay-per-views, because boxing, you're buying the pay-per-view for the main event. No one knows these guys who are fighting in the undercard unless you're a diehard boxing fan. I know at least one person fighting on every undercard in every UFC pay-per-view. You know, like the undercard or the main event, just the fights prior to the main event. Like Sugar Shane O'Malley, like, he's always, you know, on a card. He's not the main one, but like, he's worth watching. He's worth the pay-per-view himself. And then later on, you get to watch a McGregor or a Khabib or, you know, whoever. Boxing sucks in that aspect, where if you're buying a fight, you're buying to watch the last guy's fight. It's a less entertaining sport, and the guys who fought before, I mean, you can imagine if the fights before Fury Wilder put me to sleep back in that pay-per-view, you can imagine how good the boxers were on a fight before Jake Paul versus Ben Askren. I mean, these guys were jokes. The one dude took the biggest dive I've ever seen in my life. The person he was fighting threw a punch and it almost hit him below the belt, but it kind of like grazed his hip. Like hardly touched him at all. Mm-hmm. But he looked at that as a chance to get out of the fight, and he fell, and they had to take him off on a stretcher. But like, it was an ultimate sell job. There's no way that could have hurt him. That could have hit me in the hip, and I would have been able to fight. I'm a weakling. So it was just a horrible event. And my question that I wrote down was, you know, Jake Paul, like, the debate is, he's bringing eyeballs to boxing. But this is horrible for boxing. The fact that some YouTuber can come in and make more money in his fights that he puts together himself, that he promotes himself, he finds his opponent, he gets his celebrity friends to perform there and sells it all on his own. I think they made $75 million total from all of this or something like that. The fact that he can do this on his own, this YouTuber, and make more money than some of your best guys, like a Terrence Crawford or something, that's an absolute joke to your sport. And it's not helping grow your sport because young YouTube fans who are rooting for Jake Paul tune in and they think it's cool, but the rest of us sports fans are watching this and we're just like, this is pathetic.
Right.
Good for Jake Paul, though, for knocking him out.
Good for Jake Paul. Yeah, and you're exactly right. I don't watch. I don't get into it at all. But I think that sort of speaks to the interest level that it's, you know, I just don't think it's popular. Maybe I'm just in the wrong friend group. None of my friends watch fighting or, you know, or boxing or anything like
that.
None of them watch
UFC at all.
And like maybe two people watch UFC. I mean, I know very little. And I think, you know, Jake Paul, like you said, that he was able to do this as a YouTube star just shows how kind of bad the whole thing is. It's just a bad
look. This could never happen with UFC either. Like, well, I'll rephrase that. So if like maybe it would just simply because like boxing, you can train or whatever. But like if Jake Paul was like, you know, Jorge Masvidal, Conor McGregor, I want to get in the octagon with you. I would pay $50 to see that because they would murder him. They could quite literally kill him in there. And I don't want to see him die or whatever. But like that would be an ass whooping that I would pay to see. And I think more people would be interested. But there's no one who could do this to the UFC who could say, you know, I'm going to, you know, find some mediocre at best fighter and have my own pay-per-view. And even though I have a huge following, they could not compete with what the UFC brings. Right. They probably couldn't even compete with Bellator. Right. And that's just sad for boxing because boxing for a long time, it was baseball, it was horse racing, it was boxing. Mm-hmm. And all three of those sports have rapidly declined. Baseball is still in the top three, but I mean, my God, boxing is just a joke of a sport now. All right, Gar, done with sports talk. I want to get into now our internet story of the week. You have it. I would like for you to run us through here and break it down for us.
Okay, so basically what happened over the course of the last few days, I believe I'm getting that timeline correct, is there's this Lakers podcast, and there are apparently two hosts, a guy and a girl, and the guy more or less, they had only recorded a few episodes, but I guess this girl has done stuff with other things, I think has done stuff with the Raiders. In past, she tweets a bunch. She doesn't tweet any videos or photos or anything. It's all just written, just word tweets.
Yes.
And apparently, I think 2 days ago, or maybe 3 days ago, she was supposedly lost to the point where or missing, and to the point where the other co-host, Josh is his name, decided to kind of tweet out saying, "Hey, need some help. I haven't heard from this girl in a few hours. You know, here's her description, blah, blah, blah." And I guess it got to the point where people were people got worried. And even like the Lakers social media account was getting involved. Like there were, I think Kevin Durant got involved.
Ice Cube's son, Kevin Durant. Yes.
Yeah. So, I mean, this was like the real deal. This wasn't just some no-name little podcast. Like, certainly people got worried, and I think over time she was found, but this was only after there was some suspicion that this girl may not even exist. This may be a whole catfish thing. And I think then it started to get turned on him. I think people were starting to accuse like, "Oh, you know, are you the one kind of typing as this girl?" And people were kind of bringing up her tweets from when she was doing stuff for the Raiders, more or less. And it was a little hard to follow, but more people are then we had some like sound experts like listening to the podcast and dissect, like slowing down the recording. Like, did a man record a woman's voice and speed it up or something like that? And the whole thing was just kind of crazy. And they pulled up all these old pictures with some just really poor Photoshops. I mean, I'm looking at some of the pictures now. I mean, it's just like with her at like a Lakers game, and it's just clearly not real. They did like a reverse Google image search, and you could see all these results and the Google pics, and just the whole thing was kind of a mess. So then I guess this guy like logged off for a little while, but people were starting to find kind of the real identity of this. So it's a bit confusing, but it's out there, and it's just, the whole thing is kind of weird to me. I mean, this is like a 3-episode podcast, these two, and I guess, I don't know if this guy was the person behind this girl just trying to make a scene, maybe trying to get some followers, but it just seems, the whole catfish thing just seems dumb. I don't know why this is something that you would do to just try to get attention. Like, you're not like in love with this girl or anything.
Yeah. You know what this all kind of summarizes to me? How weird sports fan Twitter is.
Yeah.
You know, like all of these people, like we have our podcast and it's just us having fun, right?
Just
talking sports, just pop culture, shitting on Tony, whatever. You know, making fun of Tony, exactly. But like these people who have a Laker picture in their avatar, the Lakers record, and you know, they're, and it's, we see it the most with Steelers Twitter.
Let me say something real quick. People who have their team's record in their Twitter name, get the hell out of here.
It is a bad look.
Something else.
If you have a picture of Juju Smith-Schuster,
Michael Gar, Lions 3-14, number one draft.
If you have a picture of Juju Smith-Schuster standing over top of Vontaze Burfict as your Twitter avatar, I got nothing for you, my friend. Yeah. You know, like these people who tweet on a random Tuesday in like June, like, you know, Ben Roethlisberger, 3,300 yards. People say he had a horrible season. Justin Herbert, 3,300 yards. People say he's the next great quarterback. The NFL, the national media hates Ben. Like on a random Tuesday in June, like shut up. Like you people are weird. And this is a perfect example of those people. And I'm not here to criticize people. You know, I'm not as someone who works in media, I don't think that only people who are writers or work in radio or television should be ones with podcasts. I think anyone should start a podcast. Anyone should write a blog. And if you want to, you know, put your analysis or your content on social media, that's fine. But these super fan accounts are run by weirdos, and I don't trust any of them.
Yeah, it's just weird. It's just really weird. I just don't know why you would go to all the trouble to do this. Because catfish is... it's kind of a real thing. I mean, you know,
I don't have any pity for anyone who's ever been catfished.
That's the thing. Like, it's a real thing, right? But I just kind of laugh, like that MTV show.
That show was ridiculous.
I watched some of those episodes, and
I don't have any pity for any of them. I don't have any pity for any of them. Yeah, you know so what? There are real people in the world that I feel bad for who have bad things happen to them, unfair things that were out of their control.
Yeah.
And you know who they aren't? Morons who fall in love with someone whose face they haven't actually seen. So yeah, I don't feel bad for you at all.
Yeah. It just, the whole thing is kind of ridiculous. So.
Yeah, it is. It is weird. It's weird that I get that like you can be connected with someone on Twitter as a follow and everything, and if you listen to their podcast, but like this is just an example of the world we live in and how it's really freaking weird. Yeah. I hope this person, nothing bad actually happened to them. It sounds like nothing really did.
Hopefully they learn a lesson or something.
What is there to learn? Yeah, they won't. People are fucking weird. All right. King of the week, Gar, you made this decision. It is, we're going with multiple kings and even some queens. Jeopardy hosts. Some queens. The hunt for Alex Trebek's replacement continues.
Yes.
The big name originally was Aaron Rodgers. Everyone loved seeing him host. And now we've got some new names for new auditions.
We do. Yes. Robin Roberts. Like her.
Love her.
Yep. George Stephanopoulos, who I know the name. And
he's he's like a legendary journalist. Yeah, yeah, I think he works for Fox or ABC now. He's been all over.
David Faber, who I found out was from CNBC.
Don't know that.
I don't know him either. I had to look him up. Joe Buck, which I'm
my guy.
Super excited about. Yes. I think he's going to be good.
I am reading Joe Buck's book right now.
Ooh.
Fantastic. Got it for my birthday. Nice. I've always been a big Joe Buck fan. He was in the same fraternity I was in, Sigma Nu. And I just find that cool.
Yeah.
And his stories from growing up as the son of a famous broadcaster and everything, and very interesting book. I'm even a bigger Joe Buck fan.
I think I don't see it as much anymore, but there was a time where Joe Buck was getting hate just because he was so, you know, boring or, you know, no emotion at all. I think he's, if not the best announcer, one of the best announcers.
I mean, I'm not here to say Al Michaels is worse than Joe Buck.
For me, it's Buck. But I mean, Al Michaels is right there too.
Nance is pretty damn good. I mean, but like Buck to me,
I'm a Joe Buck guy over Jim Nance.
See, just Joe Buck to me, and he's great at football. But like Joe Buck to me is the sound of October baseball.
Yeah, I agree.
He's been calling World Series literally since I've been alive. 1996 was his first World Series with Tim McCarver, and he's the sound of October baseball.
Yeah. Does a great job. Yes. And then LeVar Burton from Reading Rainbow.
Bang.
And I think he's going to be good too.
Yes.
I'm assuming he's like 88 years old.
Yeah, we don't. No, that's my thing. Old. It's like, but here's the thing, Gar.
He's been doing that show since like the 80s, so he's got to be up there.
And this is like after your dog dies, you go and you adopt a dog that's 9 years old. Like... Listen, don't get me wrong. Exactly. This dog needs a home. Analogy. It's a sweet dog.
I'm excited. Sweet. Yeah. Knowledgeable. I think he has potential.
It's going to make me very happy, but like we're about to go through something that we just went through.
Oh,
and do we need to go through this? I would rather go through it another 10 years from now rather than 10 months.
Let me look up the exact age real quick. that's a perfect analogy. He's 64 right now.
Oh, okay.
The picture next to his name is not doing him any favors.
No,
he is.
Okay, so it's a hard 64.
He's a hard 64.
That Reading Rainbow money was spent on some good times, fast cars and loose women.
Oof.
Reading Rainbow. Oof.
No, but I'm excited nonetheless. I just to see him, just because I haven't seen him since I was a kid, because I stopped obviously I haven't watched Reading Rainbow in ages. But I'm excited, and I'm curious. I'm curious when they are going to kind of decide.
They're going to milk it.
Yeah. My girlfriend Anna was watching Jeopardy tonight. It was Anderson Cooper again. I think Anderson Cooper is a very good choice. So I'm curious to see. But I think you're right. I think they're going to take their sweet old time to do this. But I wish they picked it.
And oh, my God. Holy cow.
He's looking sharp, with the
Miami Vice white blazer, Don Johnson in the building.
Dalton Johnson, boy. Yeah, say it like you're in the strip.
There we go.
Oh, my goodness.
You've told me about this mask, a Jameson mask.
Jameson.
From a kid who in high school told us he was allergic to alcohol.
Yeah, because I liked weed better. Fight me.
There you go.
What do you want?
I respect that.
I want to introduce y'all to somebody.
Oh. Okay.
This is my buddy Jonathan, who I work with.
Hi, Jonathan.
What's up, Jonathan?
He's the best. He's the absolute greatest. He's a beautiful man. Ride home from work right now.
Nice.
Okay. Jonathan, welcome to the Underpaid and Overrated podcast.
Welcome to the greatest podcast of all time.
Dalton. Now we're just seeing a laundry. Oh, there's Jonathan. Hi, Jonathan. All right, Dalton, we brought you on. You actually have talked to me about what you want to pitch to us on this episode. It's been a while. If you want to go with that, you can. Or if you got something else to go with, you can go with that. But the floor is yours.
Well, you know, I do have a great idea that I do want to discuss with you gentlemen.
Okay.
At some point in the future here.
Okay.
But we have this beautiful resource in Jonathan where you could potentially get a look into the minds of what it's like to work with me.
I like that.
if each of you just ask Jonathan a question,
I guess
that could be kind of neat potentially for our viewers. As you would see underneath, I have labeled myself as the king.
Yes.
Jonathan, not so much a question, just blink twice if you're being held hostage right now. If you're in any discomfort in any way, we can help you.
All right, Jonathan, I will start this off. Jonathan, I've known Dalton since I was 8 years old. He's my best friend. But I could not imagine, I've never worked a day anywhere with him. We've worked for the same companies before, but we worked in different areas. I do know that he has a strong work ethic, and I know that he does have a lot of attention to detail. What is he like as someone, you know, who can be a fun guy, but what's his serious switch like when it is flipped?
I guess, like, when he's serious, like, I really don't know how to, like, describe it. I guess he, like, if he puts his mind to it, like, he can, like, do what he wants to do, like, with his job.
Okay. And another question I have is, Dalton is someone who I would describe as the common man. He is not high maintenance. He, you know, is very down to earth. But in the industry that you both work in, you're sometimes dealing with the 1% of America, if you will, some very rich and sometimes snobby and insensitive people. How does Dalton's personality mix with them?
I think it mixes pretty well.
Yeah?
He has a good connection. Like, when he first started working here, he didn't have a clue who the members were. But then as he started getting to know them better, like, he can latch onto their personality just fine.
Okay. Gar, you got anything?
After work, have you hung out with him at all? And if so, what was that experience like? Do you ever just go out, like, happy hour, have a beer? Does he just tell you some incredible stories?
I not hang out you with ever him. Do? Only, like, on car rides with him sometimes. Like,
okay. If I never
go back from home, like, home.
Are those the greatest car rides of all time?
Yeah, they can be.
What do you think of Dalton's music choices?
It's pretty good.
Pretty good?
Yeah.
Jonathan, I want to ask, and, you know, if you don't want to reveal health information, you don't have to, but I want to ask if you have any lung problems, because I've been in many cars with Dalton, and there's sometimes his car seems to have some smoke problems inside of it. So I was wondering if that has ever affected you during your time there, and maybe does his Kia Soul still smoke inside? He hit some skunks from time to time as well. Has that problem continued since he's moved to Chicago?
Yeah, it kind of has. That doesn't affect me at all, though.
Okay.
Like, growing up, I've had parents that smoked, so I kind of got used to it.
Okay. Well, Dalton's not smoking. This is a car defect, right? Yes.
It's a car,
It's a car problem.
It's old cars he drives.
I hit a lot of skunks.
Yeah, man.
Real problem.
All right, that's all I got for Jonathan. I appreciate you coming on the show and thanks, shining some light on Dalton.
Yeah.
All right, Dalton, thanks, you have any final words here?
Gentlemen, keep on making me that cheddar. Where's our co-host?
Tony's in Denver.
Tony's in Denver?
Yes.
In my territory? Denver. What's he doing in that Mile High City?
He's celebrating his birth month. His birthday was last week, but he just wants to take all the time he wants.
That's not like how it works.
Like a 16-year-old girl.
Tony's been on one show in the last 4 weeks.
He's like in his mid-20s, correct?
Yeah. Yes.
And he's taking a birthday month?
Yeah, that's really embarrassing.
I'm going to have to sit Tony down.
We're going to talk to him.
More like Antonetta, you know, because he's a girl. All right, Dalton, you get our new friend home safely, and we will talk to you next week. All right, my friend.
That sounds like a plan.
Thanks, guys.
All right, love you, brother.
I love it, Jonathan, my man.
Jonathan, that kid was perfect. He was Jonathan. I'll tell you what, right now, I didn't listen in to what they said before, but I can promise you, Jonathan had no prior knowledge that he would be on a podcast.
Yeah, he had
no idea. Called me. I ignored him and I texted him. I just texted him the link, said, "We're recording. Come on and join." He was probably just calling me to talk.
Yeah.
But I sent him that link, and Jonathan was put on the spot of all spots. And
did a good job.
I could not imagine, like, this kid, you know, he looked young.
He looked
young. Probably just asking, you know, he was probably like, you know, maybe even in high school, who knows?
He wants to go home.
He just wants to go home. His boss is driving him home, and now he has his two people he's never talked to asking about his boss.
Yeah.
Like,
hidden skunks.
Hidden skunks. All right, Gar, let's wrap up the show. Rap review time. It's Juice WRLD. We made the bold claim saying that one of Juice WRLD's songs would be a song that you really liked.
Yeah.
Come and Go. What's your grade for Juice WRLD and how'd you like Come and Go?
Okay. So Come and Go, I liked, I didn't love, but I liked. And I think for a rapper, I think saying I liked something is pretty good. Listen to a couple
like,
of,
yeah, I just really like that song. I think it's like
and good, I liked it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Overall, I'll give him a B.
Wow.
Tempted to say B minus, but I'll go B. Wow. He was good. Okay. He was good.
You like Juice WRLD.
It was a good sound.
You and every 16-year-old are big Juice WRLD fans now. Yep.
You
know
it. Yeah. So a B.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong. Have you done Rick Ross before?
I don't think you've assigned me that.
All right, so Rick Ross will be your next one. My three songs I recommend: Hustlin', BMF, and The Devil Is a Lie are my three. Rick Ross to me is someone who's significantly better as a feature in someone else's song. I think those are like where he shines more personally, but those are three good songs, and you can pick other ones. 8 Ball's another really good song from him. So yes, Rick Sounds Ross good. Is Rick your Ross. Next assignment. Tony's two cents. I'm going to take this one. And I said we were going to save the vaccine talk for the show. You got your first shot last week, right?
Yep.
And what'd you go, Pfizer?
I went Pfizer. I was originally scheduled for J&J, and they pulled that. And
yes,
then,
that's right.
But they kept the clinic going, and very thankful for that. Mm-hmm. And I got Pfizer, yeah.
Okay, so Thursday I got my first shot. I got Moderna. And I want to vent here because, correct me if I'm wrong, but it feels like Pfizer is like the iPhone, and I feel like I'm texting with green bubbles right now as a Moderna person.
I know a lot of Pfizer people. Yeah,
You know, Pfizer just seems like the cool kid shot. And when I found out 45 minutes before I got the shot that like I hopped in the shower at 12:15. Aubrey yelled, "Hey, do you want to get vaccinated at 1 o'clock? Like they're doing it right down the road."
Yeah.
And I was like, "Yeah." So I like finished my shower, went right down there. It was like a quick thing. I didn't have anything scheduled beforehand. But she said it was Moderna, and part of me, like 5% of me, literally wanted to be like, "Moderna's not cool."
Yeah.
I mean,
I could just wait a couple more days.
Yeah, I feel like the guy who gets an RC Cola at the Pens games.
Yep.
You know, right. Like what are we doing right now?
Yeah. Yeah. No, that's okay. But
so if Pfizer is iPhone and Moderna is Samsung, what is Johnson & Johnson? It's got to be like the burner phone drug dealers buy it at Family Dollar.
Yeah, you only get
and throw into the river.
Right. Yeah. Honestly. Yeah, I don't know. I think I have like one friend who was able to get the J&J before it got pulled.
Really?
Yeah, but I know a lot of Pfizer people, so I'm glad I'm in the
cool club. Any Moderna people?
Probably a few.
Not any cool ones.
Yeah, I don't talk to them anymore. If that's what you're
asking. My whole family's Pfizer.
I think a lot of my family's Pfizer. Yeah,
I'm very lucky to have been vaccinated.
And though. Anna was Pfizer.
Yeah. Oh, she was. Yep. Yeah, Aubrey was Pfizer. Yep. But you know, Tony, he'll never get a vaccine. All right.
Tony refuses.
Let's wrap this up. Noah's no doubters. I am just a remarkable 2-11 on this show. Just it's incredible.
Quite frankly,
2-11
is what you
if you are me. Fading me, you are golden right now. I highly recommend people to fade me. 2-11 on this show. I went 0-2 with my last two picks. We're gonna go Mets money line -125. Sure. All right. You know, I think they're playing. Mets. And then we're going to go with the Indians -1.5 against the Yankees. The Yankees suck right now. Aaron Civale's on the hill for the Tribe, and he is 3-0 this season. So those are my two picks. Indians -1.5, Mets money line. Fade me.
Okay.
Gar?
Fade me. Yeah. I'm going to take the trying to look at some hockey. See, I'm so tempted to say, first of all, quick shout out. I feel horrible for any Penguins -1.5 bettors yesterday.
Andrew Filippone. Did you listen to Pony and Mahler today?
I didn't. I heard he had it.
He delivered one of his best rants of all time. Because Mahler is like, he was like, let's go through this. It's 6-0. He goes, I gave my wife the remote. I turn on, she turns on American Horror Story. He's like, okay, it's 6-1, comfortable. 6-2, comfortable. 6-3, comfortable. 7-3. Thank you, Sidney Crosby, my guy. 7-4, not worried. 7-5.
Right.
7-6. Give me the remote. I'm watching it. And then he was like, I just knew an empty net goal wasn't happening.
Oh my God. That's amazing. So apologies to those. I think I'm going to take Penguins -1.5 this time because Sullivan was pissed after that game. And some of the Twitter people who were at that practice, apparently there was a long talk on the ice that lasted over 10 minutes from Sullivan to the boys. I'm going to take Penguins -1.5. They are very aware they can't do that again. And I don't think they will. And then I will also take none of the lines for basketball are out. I'm looking at the matchups. Here's the thing. I'm a big Milwaukee Bucks fan. I'm going to take the 76ers. The Bucks, not only have they not been very good as of late, but they do not cover as well. Even when they do win, they have a tough time covering the spread. I think the 76ers right now are still better. So even though they are on the road, I will take the 76ers and whatever that line is. I think they're going to be favored, probably not by a ton.
Okay.
And we're going to go with that.
The Pens -1.5, 76ers, and Tony didn't even text us the parlay
he's probably drunk on
probably
some girly drink they found at the bar. He's got one of those,
the worst.
Probably a tiara right now.
He's probably at a QAnon convention in Colorado, in the mountains somewhere, trying to storm the Denver airport and find out where the Freemasons are hiding the 1% during bomb times or something. All right. Gar, any final thoughts? Long episode today, but
episode.
I'm not mad about it.
Neither am I. Long episode. Good to be, good to have another one under the belt and just enjoy it.
Yeah,
I don't know what I'm supposed to. What we're supposed to enjoy. Yeah, rubber match tomorrow. Tigers won 5-2 in the second one, so rubber match tomorrow.
Play us, beat us in a 9-inning game.
I don't know if you guys can either.
Follow us on social media. Hit that subscribe all button and tune in next week. We will talk you then. Goodbye.